Good morning and welcome to St. Mark's on this, the fifth Sunday of Lent. Worship would not be the same without each and every one of you here this morning. We're so glad you're with us today. Our service continues with a penitential order beginning on page 351 in the Book of Common Prayer and on page 3 of your bulletin. Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins.
God have mercy and endures forever.
Please kneel as able. Hear the commandments of God to God's people. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of bondage. You shall have no other gods but me. Amen. Lord, have mercy. You shall not make for yourself any idol. Amen. Lord, have mercy. You shall not invoke with malice the name of the Lord your God. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. Amen. Lord, have mercy. Honor your father and your mother. Amen. Lord, have mercy. You shall not commit murder. Amen. Lord, have mercy. You shall not commit adultery. Amen. Lord, have mercy. You shall not steal. Amen. Lord, have mercy. You shall not be a false witness. Amen. Lord, have mercy. You shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor. Amen. Lord, have mercy. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Therefore, together, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand as able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you alone can bring into order the unruly wills and affections of sinners. Grant your people grace to love what you command and desire what you promise, that among the swift and varied changes of the world, our hearts may surely there be fixed where true joys are to be found. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
Thank you. reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, "Know the Lord," for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." As he also says in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplication with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he had suffered, and having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. Having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Jesus and his disciples have ridden into town. And in the text we just read, the festival of the Passover is just about in full swing. Among those who made the journey to Jerusalem, the text tells us there were some Greeks. And did you notice, we don't get much detail about those Greeks. Just that they have a single request that they make known to Philip. When they say, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." It's not clear exactly why they say this. In fact, there seems to be some sense that the gospel writer is using these Greeks and their desire solely for the purpose of leading to and leaning into Jesus' answer that happens later in the same text. So who knows exactly why they wanted to see him? Curiosity, maybe. The gossip that was stirring around town. You know the rumor mill. Were they looking maybe to corner him? Or just to see if what they had heard about him was true? At this point, Jesus' reputation indeed precedes him. And whatever the reason, it seems that they were drawn to him. Maybe just to see what this guy was all about. We're left to wonder exactly why, though, because all we get is their request. "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." You know the old adage, right? Seeing is believing. And so it makes me wonder today, what does it mean exactly to see Jesus? For those Greeks, I guess it meant laying eyes, literally, on the man for whom all the fuss was about, that they might discover for themselves whether or not he was worthy of all the fame that his entrance into the city had just drummed up. But for us, gathered today, all these years, millennia later, knowing what we know now, where the story goes from here, how it will end in glory, but what it takes to get to that glory, what does it mean to see Jesus? John's Jesus does seem to answer the question, in fact. He says that to see him will be no ordinary viewing, no simple sightseeing adventure. In fact, if you want to see the Christ, then he says, turn your mind's eye towards this, a grain of wheat. And then just stay there for a minute. In order for that grain, Jesus reminds us, to become anything more than it already is, then it must first die unto itself. Without that death, he says, it remains paralyzed as a single grain. But with that death, through that death, it grows into something altogether more, experiencing a metamorphosis that quite literally bears fruit. The grain must first be cracked open and broken, no longer its former self, so that it becomes a life-giving fruit bearer. We're starting to see Jesus. See, this is so much more than an agricultural analogy, because Jesus is pointing to the death that he will soon die, his own breaking open through which God will bear fruit. Want to see Jesus? Well, then we must turn and face the cross, where a gruesome, unspeakable death will soon occur, a death that is God's conduit for the abundant fruit-bearing of salvation. Friends, we read this gospel on the last Sunday of Lent before we gather together for the holiest of weeks, beginning with Palm Sunday next week. And then we will gather here again to begin that long walk into Jerusalem with the knowledge that that walk always leads us to Golgotha. And today, we get a head start. A reminder that the only way to the empty tomb is by way of the cross. The only way the seed can ever bear fruit is if it is first broken. We're on the cusp of a journey that is filled with so much pain, so much hurt, betrayal, lostness, and loneliness that we are tempted, and rightfully so, I might say, to want to close our eyes and just wait till the end. Just hold out and wait for the upswing, for the glory of that Easter morning, the bright resurrection light. But y'all, walking with closed eyes will never be the way to really see Jesus. Instead, it's with open eyes that we can begin to understand that with a commitment to see Jesus, really, a focus begins to become clear. That to see Jesus is to see that cross. And to see the cross for what it is could make us very well want to look anywhere but there. In order to bear fruit, though, the seed must first die. And so Jesus says, do not turn away. That's right, to see Jesus, don't turn away from the pain and the hurt of the world, that which is so hard to swallow, harder still to deal with. Don't turn away from the world's cries. Don't close your eyes, he says, for you'll miss he whom you so wish to see. Our head start today isn't about racing to the empty tomb. It's about further opening our eyes to the truths that Jesus would have us see and view and perceive. That, as he says, in order to serve Christ, we must be willing to follow Christ to where he goes, to serve where he serves, to love how he loves, to be with those with whom Christ dwells. A single grain of wheat, it'll soon be broken. And Jesus himself, with his body broken, hung from the cross, will hang there for all to see. And we must be so brave as to not turn away. For if we focus in there, we will see that it brings into clearer focus the earthly ministry that led him to that cross in the first place. All that healing and preaching and teaching and loving the least of these. All that breaking bread with folks like tax collectors and sinners. All that reaching out to touch the untouchable. All that finding of the lost, that gathering up of the scattered. All that helping piece back together the broken, breathing life and love into cold, dark places. All that searching for and then leaning in to the margins of society. Don't turn away from all of that, and then yes, we will see Jesus. Where might we turn today? Where might you turn today? Not away from, but towards. How might a turning towards be a spirit shift of seeing, an opening of eyes and heart and soul? With eyes open, what are we called to see and perceive in new holy ways? Sir, we wish to see Jesus, is what they said. Take a look at the grain broken in order to bear fruit, the body battered and hung to die, the Christ who came into the world in a manger and then spent a life serving in the margins, and you'll see Jesus all right. My friends, when we see him, may we have the courage to keep on looking, the commitment to keep on seeing, and the faith to not turn away. Amen. Standing together as able, let us reaffirm our faith through the words of the Nicene Creed, found on page 358 in the Book of Common Prayer and on page 10 in your bulletin. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Amen. Liam, Michael, and others whom we name silently or aloud. For those celebrating birthdays this week, especially Ken, David, Chris, Betty, and Catherine. For those celebrating wedding anniversaries this week, especially Bob and Ruby, and John and Nancy.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that, with all the saints, they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but in life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Rejoicing in the friendship of all the saints, let us commend our services and ourselves and one another and all our life into Christ our God.
To you, O Lord, our God.
O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Please stand as able. My friends, the peace of the Lord be always with you. Please be seated. Come on, girls. We got some guests today, y'all. We got a guest announcer to start us off. Come on up, girls. A booth of what?
Cookies.
And you can pay, how can you pay?
You can pay cash or card, and that's $6 a
month. Yeah, great. And I'm putting you on the spot. Where do you meet? Where does your troop meet? You meet here. Did y'all know that? They meet here, downstairs. We love having y'all here. We love cookies even more. And did y'all know that I found this out today, there is a public speaking badge, right?
We can make it.
You can make a public speaking badge. What do you think? I think they got it, right? Thank you. Thank you. So you'll be in the cloister room after the service, right? Cash, card, or however else. Okay. Thank y'all so much. Thank you. Betty. Tough act to follow, Betty. Girl Scout cookies.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Sing Out Your Joy is the name of our concert this afternoon at 4 o'clock at First Presbyterian Church. The Choral Society will be presenting this under the direction of our brilliant musical director, Andrew Harry. 6 members of the St. Mark's Choir sing with the Choral Society. We do not want to miss this concert. During the rehearsal yesterday, when the singers sit down and look at each other and go, we sound pretty good. That's a good sign. They really do sound remarkable. And I will say that none of this could happen without the help and support of St. Mark's, because this concert is put together by us being in the parish hall every Thursday night for 2 hours. And we have been with the resident choir here at St. Mark's, and we are so honored that you have supported us throughout the years and allowed us to do concerts of this caliber. You will hear everything from standards to spirituals to gospel to folk music, and I promise We would be so honored to have you, and it means so much to have you there. Now, that being said, normally this concert closes out our season. That's not the case this year, and I'm very, very excited and very proud to announce to you that on April the 27th, the Choral Society of West Georgia will be in collaboration with the LaGrange Symphony Orchestra. We will be in concert at Cowley Auditorium, and we will be doing an all-Broadway concert, so you do not want to miss that. Thank you, and I do hope to see you there this afternoon. You do not want to miss this concert. Thank you.
Thank you, Betty. Thank you. We're rounding out Lent, y'all, so you've heard me say it. I'll say it again. Morning prayer happens here in the nave, 9 o'clock Monday through Friday to finish out our Lenten journey. With that, our Sunday school session ended with the last session of Flannery O'Connor and Lenten themes. Marianne Wilson took us on quite the journey through Flannery's work, and there's a lot of, if you came to any or all of those or any bit, you know that there's a lot of food for thought that will continue percolating after this session. So thank you so much for that, Marianne. We will wrap up our Lenten soup and sermons Wednesday night sessions this Wednesday, where we'll look at one more sermon from Presiding Bishop Michael Curry. Join us for that if you've been coming. Join us for that if you have not been coming. Holy Week, real quick, the schedule for Holy Week starts with Palm Sunday. We're going to meet out at the Celtic Cross, weather permitting. We'll have a full cadre of acolytes, and the whole thing will process in. You know how the Liturgy of the Palm goes, and we're really excited for that. Then on Tuesday of that week, there's a renewal of vows service that's held at the Cathedral in Atlanta at 11 o'clock. If you've never been to a renewal of vows service, it's for ordained and lay folks alike to do exactly what it sounds like. Renew your commitment to God and God's church, whether that's in an official ordained capacity or whether that's in a lay capacity. So I'll be going, Daniel's going along with some others. If you're interested, talk to us, and we're happy to carpool and get a group up. So let us know about that. Then Wednesday at 5:30, we'll have a tenebrae service. That's a service of shadows, and if you've ever been to a Lessons and Carols, it sort of mirrors that. Not exactly, but there's some lessons, there'll be some call and response, and then there's some hymns and Tazze-type chants. So join us to really kick off Holy Week like that. Thursday evening at 5:30 will be our Maundy Thursday service, complete with foot washing and stripping of the altar. Good Friday at noon here will be a service of the Solemn Collects and Veneration of the Cross. Holy Saturday at 9 a.m. for those that are going to Easter-fy the space, or if you'd like just a quiet space to be in the morning, that's at 9 o'clock here for a short service, and then the Easter Vigil will happen at 8 p.m. on Saturday. And let me just one more plug for the Vigil. If you've never been to a Vigil, or if you think, well, I'll just wait till Sunday morning for Easter, come on to the Vigil. It is old, it is ancient, it is weird, it is awesome. It is the story of God in a big old awesome service. Join us for that. We're excited about it. And then Easter morning, 8:30 service, 9:30 we'll be in the backyard with Easter egg hunt and potluck, and then 10:30 service. And then Easter Monday, don't call me. On Sunday, I need some Easter bunnies. So there's a sign up. There are a couple sign ups in the cloister room. The hope, and y'all, I'll be honest, this is a totally selfish request. I've got a couple girls that want to hunt some Easter eggs. So all of our youth are gone because it's spring break. So they're going to help us pack those Easter eggs on Palm Sunday when we meet. But then we need a few faithful folks with their bunny ears to go throw out the eggs in the playground area and in the backyard prior to that 9:30 egg hunt. We also need a few folks to sign up to bring some muffins and just continental breakfast type thing. We'll have food and coffee outside so that we can share the Easter morn in the sunshine. We'll also have some coffee up here in the parish hall for those who can't make it out. So need help with that. The sign-up sheets are in the cloister room. Anything else? Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Eucharistic Prayer A begins on page 361 in your Book of Common Prayer and page 15 of your bulletin. This is God's table, and all are welcome. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that fervent in prayer and in works of mercy and renewed by your word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the peace.
This is the table, not of the church, but of Jesus Christ. It is made ready for those who love him and for those who want to love him more. So come, you who have much faith and you who have little, you who have been here often and you who have not been for a long time or ever before, you who have tried to follow and you who have failed. Come not because the church invites you. It is Christ, and he invites you to meet him here. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. May the road rise with you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rain fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the hollow of God's hand. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is with you this day and will be evermore. Amen. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.